Hello, I'm Brian Boring, and welcome to part 8 of the Distinguished Lecture Series entitled Listening to the Prairie. This segment features distinguished lecturer Ed Baggs. Mr. Baggs holds a degree in animal science from Texas A&M and an MS in agricultural education from Tarleton State. He is the Collin County Extension Agent for Agriculture. So let's join Mr. Baggs as he lectures on listening to the prairie over the roar of urbanization.
As it says up here, I'm with the Texas Cooperative Extension Service Agricultural Agent, and I do have some natural resources responsibilities as far as that's concerned also, and I am your county extension agent for Collin County. The Cooperative Extension Service used to be the Agricultural Extension Service. Y'all remember that? Yeah, we've been that since 1914, and all of a sudden last year they said we're going to change our name. You know, go figure. You know, that's, I guess that's what they do in College Station. So they passed that down, and we did change the name. And it is, I think it was to get the mindset of our clientele more that we are just more than agricultural. I think some of the past mindset from the old time was sows, cows, and plows. Y'all heard that term. See, but now we are getting into more of the natural resource and urban type programming. And those are major issues because that's where most of our population lies in the state now, is in the urban and suburban areas. And so that's we have to change as our clientele changes. And so we do move in that direction. And the name probably does fit better and work a little bit better to meet the needs and the identity of extension as far as that clientele is concerned. Our mission, of course, is to provide outreach, continuing education program service to the people of Texas. All of our educational programs are research-based. I can't give you my opinion. I can tell you my jokes, but I can't give you my personal opinion on certain items. It has to be research-based information. So that's what we do try to provide to you. There again, I am your agent for Collin County. That is my particular responsibility. I do have state and some national responsibilities, but the main part of my work deals directly here in Collin County. I take it for granted that everybody is from in Collin County in here. So in every county, 254 counties in the state of Texas, they all have at least one extension agent across the state. So we have a very good networking system, and we also have access to our research stations all across the state and in College Station, that their main responsibility is to support county programs. They do some research at the research stations. We also do some research locally here within the county to see how a certain, whether it be plant or new GMO technology or a herbicide or planting method, anything along those lines, how it works under this certain environment. We can do it at the research stations, but they can duplicate a lot of things, but they can't duplicate everything exactly like it's going to happen here in Collin County. So that's we do some of that research there also. A little bit about, you know what grass this is? You can't say, Dave. Oh, y'all are too good, see? I'm the side oaks grammar, right? State grass is Texas. Yeah. So a little bit about Collin County before I kick this thing off, too. I know we're getting very urbanized here. We have about 534,000 acres in Collin County. We still have 369,000 of those acres are still filed for an agricultural exemption at the Collin County District Appraisal Office, and that's on record. So that tells us, that gets us at about 65% of the land area in Collin County is still in some type of agriculture. We, on an annual basis, average annual basis, over the last 3 years, we plant around harvest 49,000 acres of wheat, right at about 35,000 acres of corn, and about 19,000 acres of sorghum and milo. And I think about 64,000 is what we use for 63,000 is used for forage production. And livestock production last year produced $20 million, and those are cash receipts, produced $20 million livestock production. Out of that total land mass was 180,000 acres. So you can see it's a very diverse, and if you add all those up, those large crops take large areas and large farmers. So that kind of, as we did that research and kind of think through that process, that tells us that we have a lot of smaller landowners out there. And that's the trend that's going across the whole state, and that'll come out a little bit later in this program. And so those in Texas, as all y'all probably are all aware of, is a privately owned state. Most of the land area in the state is owned by private landowners. And so really you have control of your own destiny. If the natural resources are out there and it's privately owned land, you're the ones that have the control of it, whether it stays or it goes or it gets changed or put into something else. With that, move into the prairies. This is what the settlers seen when they came across there. Vast seas of grasses dotted with springs and crossed with streams and rivers. This is not an early settler, by the way. But what do the native grasses provide for? So what grass is this? Y'all are good. What is it? That's close. We'll take it. It's hard to tell from those pictures, too. I'd call it a little blue stem, Dave. What would you call it?
No comment.
Okay. We'll go with the Indian love grass. That's fine. You bet. It's, what do these grasses provide for us? In a way, I mean, whether you live in urban, rural, suburban, it doesn't matter. These grasses for us can provide anything from a clean and safe drinking water system to steaks on the grill, because it produces a tremendous amount of forage. Also, the best filtration system we have for the waterways, our streams, our rivers, our tanks and ponds. When those overflow, when we get the rains, we get sediment washing in from the fields or even from the city as far as that goes. At some point in time, if it has an opportunity to run through these tall grass prairies, then it is an excellent filtration system for filtrating those sediments going into the water system, not only the groundwater system, but the underground reservoirs. It filtrates those too. These native grasses have a tremendous root zones. Their root zone is tenfold what a established pasture would be, or established grass, or introduced grass, whatever title you want to put on it. So they act in that method also. They can filtrate very deep. They also open up the soil to create organic matter, organic action going into that soil and incorporating nutrients back into it. So they serve a wide variety of purpose and are very important to all of us. Grazing lands, single largest land use in the state, 120 million acres, or 70% of the state, still is in grazing lands. 94 million acres are in range land, and 17 million pasture land, and grazed forests are 1 million acres. So it's still a lot, and that's statewide. It's still a large area. Blackland prairies, that's where we live, right? So we have 12.6 million acres in the Blackland prairies. Includes Collin, Dallas, and Hunt, and Ellis is in there too. Those are part of the largest counties that are in the Blackland prairies. And we're kind of set right in the heart of it, in the widest part of the Blackland prairies. So it's mainly smooth. Houston black clay is the predominant soil type through this area. These grasses are very well adapted. Certain type of grasses are very well adapted. The native ones to this area, I think, is Eastern Grama, Little Blue Stem, Big Blue Stem. This is what they was passed, native grasses to the Blackland prairies. Little Big, Indian, Side Oats, Tall, and Perennial Forbs. That's what that was long ago, but it's changed. What caused all it to change? I mean, it wasn't just building the cities, and you know, people gotta have places to live. We all understand that. And we have to, you know, work with it and live with it. And just make sure everybody understands what we're doing today, that we do need to preserve at some point in time, though. But what made all this change? Any feedback? Well, agriculture had a role in it, exactly. Even before agriculture, cotton came here. You know, Collin County used to be the onion capital of the state. Y'all know that? Yeah, y'all remember that. Y'all been here longer than me. Used to grow more onions here. I mean, onions love this place. It was unbelievable. How come we don't grow onions anymore? Can't get the labor. Yeah, they can make more labor building houses. You know, you can't pay somebody, you know, $10-$12 an hour to work in an onion field. But back then, when we were more of an agrarian type society, that was a common thing to work in the onion fields. We had plenty of them out there. And then cotton came in. Cotton was a king. When I first came to Collin County over 4 years ago, we were farming about right at 4,000 acres of cotton. This year, we're going to be lucky to get in 1,200. We lost two gins in the process in that time. And that's because they can't make a living. I mean, they just can't do it. They're all switching over to dry land corn. Dry land corn was introduced to Collin County 10 years ago, and it was introduced by the Extension Service. It was run on an experiment from the agent that was here before me, probably the biggest contribution he ever made to the agricultural industry in this county was to get that done. And it was done through one of these demonstration plots that I was explaining, talking to you about earlier. Farmer said, let's try it. He said, corn's not going to grow here. And he said, let's just try it. Let's put in a demonstration shop plot, do some research, and see how it works. Took it, ran with it. It's the biggest profitable crop in this county, dry land corn. We'll average 150 bushels an acre on corn. Don't have to have a dryer, let it dry on the stalk. Bring it in off out of the field at 14% moisture. So we don't have any energy expense with the big dryers. We have a good market. What's over here in Prosper? What's over in Prosper? Biggest ag industry in Prosper. Prosper, not very big. Mayard Chicken Farm. Yeah, chickens love corn. You bet. But so that was a ready market for the corn too. A lot of these cotton farmers have just switched gears, sold off their cotton equipment, and moved over and switched over to corn. They have to diversify. Some of the other ones that have just hung on and farmed cotton for generations, those are about the only ones we got left in the county. But they're really struggling, but bless their heart, they try. And they're good folks, and we got to support them all we can. Chasing another rabbit about the county. So this is what it was. We never did answer the question. What made it change? Agriculture, good answer. That is one phase of it. But it was fires, natural fires. You know, back then, when the invaders came in, the junipers, the oaks, the elms, we had natural fires by lightning or Smokey the Bear. So however the fire got started, it got started. But there wasn't anybody here to put it out. And so it just burned. And that kept the invaders in check and kept our native grasses predominant. And then once we came in and we had our fire trucks and, you know, fire was bad. And so when we had a fire, we put it out. And really, that was a big impact on the prairie lands and the grasses. Present there again, just what we visited with just earlier, mesquite, oak, elm, juniper, hoosac, and these are the predominant grasses now that we have in our native grass pastures, hairy grama, Texas winter, and buffalo grass. There is still some stands out there, blue stems. I hadn't side oats, grama, y'all see much of that in the county? Don't see it very well at all. So, you know, that's what happens, the fire, the agricultural, and also livestock. You know, you can lump that into agriculture, the lady said back here. Livestock hinders the native grass production very much. If you don't have a good grazing management plan, it will hinder the growth of the native grasses dramatically. Impact of rangeland, economic stability. In the state, rangelands or outdoor recreational activity, which is tied to the grasslands, as such, brings in approximately, brings in approximately about $70 million a year just for outdoor activities. So it is an economic impact. We talked a little bit about our water quality and quantity. It does act as the best filtration system we got there, and most economical too, as far as filtering the sediments out there. Water's going to be a big issue in this state. I think everybody is aware of that. It's going to be a tremendous issue. Whether you're a farmer, rancher, landowner, non-landowner, or live in an apartment, it doesn't matter. Somehow it's going to trickle-down effect is going to affect you, because if you work for a corporation, they're not going to be able to expand because there's not going to be enough water to support a growth in population or industry. That is going to be a very limited resource in the very near future. And it's going to limit it. And so if you're working somebody that for a grocery chain and they depend on expansion to keep you working and the people aren't moving in, then you're stuck. You're kind of there. So it's going to be it's a very limiting factor, water is. And so these rangelands can help us improve the quantity and quality of the water. Of course, wildlife population, I think that's a given. It's home to very many vertebrae. In birds and deer and such, and that's also an economic impact as far as recreation is concerned. Recreation, we already touched on that. Social needs of our state, that's just kind of the ties in also with recreation, and we like to identify as Texans, you know, as being native Texans and being part of nature. Texas has kind of got that image about them, so, you know, that relates to us. When you think about Texas, that's kind of what comes to mind. Water quality and supply, we already visited. Reduced erosion, reduced pollution, and capture runoff and sediment. It does a very good job at that, at these pastures and waterways and around tanks. We've done some tests where we have done that. In fact, we're in the process of doing one right now. I was over there before I came over here, seeing how we were coming along, and I'll touch base on it with it later, planting grasses around stock tanks, these native grasses, and doing the comparison of not planting them and versus planting them, and then doing some tests down at the very base of each side after a rainfall, and you can see the difference. Future Texas, we are an urban society, but we all want a rural lifestyle. Certainly nothing wrong with that, nothing wrong with it at all. Folks move to Collin County and come out and buy 10, 15, 20 acres, maybe even 5 acres, and that's okay, and they work in Dallas. Certainly nothing wrong with that, but they want that rural lifestyle. And if there's some native grasses out there or they want to establish some type of grass, you know, we can encourage them to do that and show them the benefits and help them get that done through proper planting methods. 80% of farms and ranches are less than 500 acres. That's across the state, and that's a growing trend. That's not going up, it's going the other way. So that's another reason. And black land prairies are now less than 1% in tall grasses. The smaller acreages tend to, that's a population chart. When you get into these smaller acreages, it seems like the smaller it is, the more livestock they want to run on it. I mean, and it's hard to, when they see the grasses out there is this tall, and then they triple the stocking rate that they're really supposed to on those grasses, and then they get them grazed down, and it deters the root growth, and now our plant's pretty much done. I mean, now we're going to go into a reverse mode on our plants, and so it's hard to, without doing some education and some visiting with them and some data collecting, it's hard to get that across from, but it is very detrimental. You can see where we've gone from 1900 to the year 2000 as far as, this is across the state, across as far as urban and rural is concerned. Very big increase. And so they have, what happens is the larger farmers, like the cotton farmers or any farmer as far as that concerned, it's very difficult to make a living in the agricultural field. I mean, 100% living and keep groceries on the table and keep shoes on the kids' feet. Especially with the new farm bill coming out, it's just, you're so dependent on the environment and the market, and you're not getting the subsidies that the people are overseas, and so you can't be competitive in the marketplace when they're getting subsidized and we're not. And so if you're a buyer, you're going to buy the cheapest grain you can if it's the same quality, and so they can produce it a lot cheaper, sell it a lot cheaper over there due to those subsidies. So that's another deal with the farm bill. In relation to this, to Lot 18, I say, well, what's that got to do with Lot 18, man? You know, get to it. So what happens is these larger farmers have these large tracts of land, and they find it more profitable, economical for them to sell it off in smaller tracts. And they just have to for survival. So they sell them off in smaller tracts for whatever reason, and this is kind of an example of one. And then it goes into this. And you can see the junipers invading, but still some grasses out there. And still, that's okay. You know, the farmer's there again. He has to make a living. If he can't make it off the land, then he's going to have to do something. And so it gets into lots, and it turns into this. But this also kind of a good example to show you can have a, I don't know, what's that house? That looks like your house, Tom. What's that cost?
No idea.
Pretty expensive house. Not a county agent's house, I tell you that. So, but you can see you can have a nice home like that. I might do my driveway a little different, I don't know. But you can see you can have a very nice house out there and you know, beauty's in the eye of the beholder. Is that a nice, do y'all like that land? This group probably does like that landscape, yes? It doesn't bother me a bit. I mean, you know, I don't use my lawnmower out there. I don't have the water, I don't have to fertilize it. You know, if the grasshoppers come in, well, you know, not much I can do about it. So, you know, that to me, I like that. That has aesthetic beauty to me. I'd leave it like that, maybe do my driveway a little bit so my wife could get up and my kids maybe could roller skate or something. Effects on urban areas. We already talked about the watersheds. The watersheds do drain from northwest to south to southwest, and the basins here are the Red and the Trinity Rivers. The more grasslands we can filter that water through before it gets down to us, the better off we're going to be when it gets down to Lake Levan. Lake Levan is being tested last year and also this year too. We're not in the unsafe zone, but we could be getting close if we're not careful. So I think this could be an important aspect of that as far as anybody upstream from us using these type grasses naturally to help us alleviate that problem. Atrazine does not break down in the water very readily, and it doesn't bond to the soil. So therefore, it gets caught in the runoff and the sediment. And apparently, it doesn't run through the grasses either, right? Because the grasses could help us with that. A very widely used product in the agricultural industry and also in some of the turf grass industries too. You know, we can't blame this all on the producers, folks. I mean, you know, yes, there are users of it, but they're not going to be, they're users, but they're not abusers. I mean, because the money's coming out of their pockets and they're barely making it anyway. So they're not going to put any more herbicides out there that they need that just to do the job. They're very conservative on that, and also time and application. And they're very well restricted also and controlled. But proper grazing managements, we visited a little bit about that, produces more grass. Talk about a little examples of animal units. We try to educate people on what animal units are. That's kind of how we figure them when we do a stocking rate, is and this is how much they eat on a monthly and a yearly basis. So you see, a horse does a pretty good job out there, 1,200 pounds on a yearly basis, and that's just an average at 1.25 animal units. So, you know, if you got 2 acres out there and 5 horses, what's going to happen? Yeah, you're pretty much done. You know, you might look real good right now, but in about year, 2 year max, and that's under ideal conditions, it's going to look like another picture coming up. And I got nothing against horses. I own horses. I love horses, but they need to be managed. We got to remember we're grass managers. We're really not livestock producers. This is how growth, grazing affects growth. This is something I didn't learn at AM. This is something Daddy did teach me. But the best rule of thumb is, and everybody can remember this, is take half, leave half. You know, if you're going to take half, leave half of it there. And that'll still sustain that root system so that plant can prevail and regrow itself to come back to where it needs to be to produce seed and regerminate. But if you know you start getting below that half stage, you're really starting to handle that root production, and now we got everything going in reverse. And it's going to be really tough for it to get it back. And the native grasses respond to that very heavily. I mean, that in grazing, what's the difference between grazing and mowing? You're still cutting it off, aren't you? It's still gone. The only big difference is that you might get some recycling out of the livestock, you know. But the grazing, you know, it's amazing. You drive, and I've done it in Collin County, you drive down the county, you know, it's what county agents supposed to do, drive down the county roads, right? I like doing that too. So we drive down the county road and see a guy over there on a brush hog, and he's got some little blue stem up here about waist high, and he's on that brush hog board, and he's just a hacking away, you know. Pull over and start hogging, hey, no, don't do that. You know, put some livestock on there or something. At least raise your mower up to 8 to 10 inches, you know, if you're going to cut it off like that. So it has the same effect. As long as we take that top growth off there, then that's going to affect the bottom growth, and that's going to affect it coming back. Pasture rotation, this is what happens if you rotate it off there properly. Take half, leave half. It's going to come back and regerminate, and you're still going to maintain a good stand. You're going to get all the other benefits that go along with it. That's what happens if you don't graze it right. Is that going to come back? Nah, it might come back, but it's going to be in junipers and prickly pears or something else. It's not going to come back native grasses, I guarantee you. It's pretty much done, and that's kind of what happens. Efforts by extension. What we're doing here today, public awareness, visiting with clientele, doing educational programs, conducting research and such, collaboration with other agencies like Dave and I were visiting with earlier today, doing some things together, and that's great. You know, we really encourage that, and we can do a better job together than we can separately. And we have to give you an unbiased approach. We have to. It's just mandated in our ethics code. There again, I can't give you my personal opinion or anybody else's. I have to give you that type of approach. Some of the things that we are working on in an urban area as far as the native grasses and conserving natural resources, I told you I was in checking on a research plot we're doing over at Chase Oaks Golf Course. It's right down the road. I went over there before I came here today checking on it. We've made them aware of this type of aspect and kind of what's going on, the benefits from it, not only for the public of Collin County, but also them as golf course managers and owners. Around their ponds, I think it's a 36-hole golf course. They got 18 of it shut down. They're redoing the whole thing. And so we're encouraging them, and they're going to go forth with it if our demonstration shows successful and has a lot of challenges to it. Show successful this year, then they'll make it over a broad base over the whole golf course, using native grasses around their ponds and along that creek bottom. Right now they're in improved pasture. They're all Bermuda grasses. Of course, they got to mow it, fertilize it, herbicide it, keep it looking nice for the golfers. And we encouraged them and showed them the benefits of the native grasses for filtration, flood control. And you got to use different types, you know, eastern grammar down in the bottom, little blue stem up on the top, and blue gram, and there's different places. And the big challenge is to get that established and still keep the erosion intact, because they're on very slopey areas going into those tanks. And we think we can work through that. They've agreed to, and of course they have to, they furnish the expense, and we just furnish the expertise in consulting. And so we'll work through that and get that done, and it'll move forward, and I think it'll be very successful. And it's not the first golf course in the county that I've consulted on with native grasses. The new one going in on Prosper, DA, anybody a golfer here? Nobody? Great. That's good. My name's Phil Mickelson. He's got consulting on another one, D.A. Wyburn Golf Course, putting that one over in Prosper. I don't know if y'all were yet. I don't think it's open yet. Started on it year before last. And they came in and said, hey, we want to bring this back as much native as we can. They're, again, to cut down on fertilizer, cuts down on the herbicide costs, cuts down their labor for mowing. There's very little maintenance to it. And so they, unfortunately, they called me after they'd already plowed up the whole everything and got it all laid out. But that's okay. You know, these are contract companies that go around, architect companies that build these golf courses, and they finish this one, then they move on to another one. So they're not local, and they don't know what grasses are native to this, to Collin County, Blackland Prairies, and which one are going to work best in what situation, what soil type. So I go out there and consult them and help them do that. And very glad to. I think it's a great step forward. And that just kind of snowballed, and then Chase Oaks and some of the other ones are really picking up on it. Beechwood over in Fort Worth, Timoron, a lot, and it's beautiful. I mean, a lot of native grasses out there, and it's just beautiful. And that's going to be a way of the future. When our water, we talk about our water resources, is going to be one of our resources that are not going to be available to us, limiting resource. What's the first one's going to go? It's not going to be home, is it? I mean, hopefully we can still get a drink of water. It's probably going to be recreation. They're probably going to be limited, monitoring recreation water. I mean, I don't know that for a fact, but I think they're going to start from the bottom and work up, and just which one is the most mandated, which one is going to maintain, you know, life quality. And they're probably going to start with recreation. So I think a lot of these golf courses are kind of picking that up. It's in Texas and saying, you know, we're going to have to cut back somehow. Where can we do that? Native grasses fits in there perfect. I mean, just perfect. And so we're excited about going forward with that. The new water line going through the county. Anybody got that going through their backyard? Nobody? Y'all seen it, right? You do? Uh-huh. Well, it runs all the way across the county. I mean, it's just a line straight across. Red Hubbard. Yeah. Right. Huge. I mean, it's pretty big. Tom will get through there. It's a big pipe going all the way across. one of the deals is with the people that are putting in that pipeline, one in the contract states that whatever ground that they tear up through there, again, this relates back to what Extension is doing to promote these native grasses. It has to go back. They do their best they can to put that back in the same vegetation it was before they dug that hole. Well, these guys, they're going to contractors. You know, they're pipe layers. They're not agronomists, they're not horticulturalists, and they're sure not, they don't know, that guy on that backhoe, he doesn't know what grass he's digging up out there when he's putting that pipe in the ground. So they called me and said, would you help us identify some of these grasses and help us establish them back like they were? And I said, I'd be more than happy to. So that's just something else we do to work through to try to get these things back. And it's great that these large corporations are making that effort and have that concern to do that. I mean, so we can all work towards a direction so everybody benefits from it. What can you do? Well, yeah, everybody got a lawn? Yeah, you can use some native grasses in the landscape. Certainly nothing wrong with that at all. Support organizations like myself. Support those organizations. It doesn't have to be monetarily. You know, if you have questions with them or have concerns or might help them volunteer-wise, whatever the need may be, just support those organizations. Like Dave's over here, that's a tremendous organization that they have there. Conservation easements, Dave's going to talk about that, right? There are conservation easements that you can use. And I believe that you can also get the exemption for those. You get the agricultural exemption for a conservation easement. Tremendous asset on preserving some of these areas. And Dave's going to go into a lot more detail on that. And estate planning. A lot of, even though you're, you might be a property owner, might not. But if you do become one, or maybe know someone that is, through these estate plans, you can leave that stuff in writing on how that property is supposed to be used, how is it supposed to be preserved. You know, you can put those in your estates to mandate exactly how that would happen. If you had, you know, 300 acres, and for instance, in native grass, and you left it to your cousin, and he sells it to McDonald's, well, that's not going to preserve much. But you can put those stipulations on how that property is supposed to be used in your estate planning. Did I hear the question? Okay. There's a, first off, when you want to purchase native grasses or plugs, however you want to do it, you want to get the closest nursery or supplier that is grown or harvested to you, because that's going to make it more adaptable to your environment. There's one in Eden, Oklahoma. I have all that information. There's really only two that's close, one in Oklahoma and one in Muleshoe. Those are the two closest sources. Well, I mean, yeah, closest, yeah. Harvesting that seed's not a big, there's just not a, you know, huge market out there for it. But you got to be careful, because some of it, if you just buy it from a supplier, it could be shipped in from almost anywhere. You don't know where its origin is. You know, you need to really be aware of the origin and find out exactly where it's coming from. And, you know, if there's a place closer, that's where it needs to, you need to get it. Yes, ma'am?
There's a Texas A&M guy that saw there was a need for this, and he's in South Arlington, and he has a little home nursery called Blue Stem Nursery.
Mm-hmm.
And you can go out there on some days and he allows seed collecting on his plate.
Oh, that's great.
And he sells the plants and the grasses in pots too.
Did you get that? Y'all can get together afterwards.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. She has a source locally, but you probably couldn't get quantities there.
Pretty much.
Like if I wanted to do 500 acres?
No.
Yeah. So landscaping, yes, I think that'd be a great resource for landscaping purposes. We tend to work on a little bit larger scale, and so we kind of need them. And also, we get a lot of those seeds in already. We're getting chasing rabbits again. We get a lot of, that mean I got to quit?
No.
We get into situations to where we want, like the eastern grommagrass. We like to get it in soaked, already soaked, been sitting there for 3 or 4 days in water, ready to go. So we get it, if we're not ready to go right into the ground, we can put it in the refrigerator and bring it out. We get real fast germination out of it, because when we go to put in these seed beds, we get everything ready, and we want to go with it quick. Our window is very small to get those in still, because we want to be as successful as we can, especially on our demonstrations. So we try to just dot every I and cross every T and make sure everything's just right. So the timing coming in on the seed, our seed bed preparation, and in some instances we don't have a seed bed, we're overseeding. And then we got to do some other methods to accomplish that, to hold back the competition during that seeding process. So, you know, you can get it many different ways in establishments. That's a great source. Thank you, ma'am. Best of Texas. Productive rangelands, wildlife, clear streams, native plants, and aesthetic beauty. Can't get any better than that, I tell you. If I go to heaven, that's what it'd be right there. All those things listed. And we can, I have the cattle out there. There's our harvesting tool. Nothing wrong with that. He's got grasses. He's not overgrazing. And you can tell he's maintained that very well. He's got a good water supply back there for him. Wildlife. Perfect home environment for it. Also can be another source of income. And here's an example of some of those native grasses planted around a stock pond, filtrating all the sediments, not only soil, but any other type of materials that would be caught in the runoff going into that pond, that these grasses filter those out going in, and there's some nice crystal water. And Aldo Leopold stated, conservation is keeping the resources in working order as well as preventing overuse. And I think that's a good statement for all of us to keep in mind as we kind of think through this. I thank you for being here this afternoon, and I'll entertain you.